The following is a rebroadcast of the Newark City Schools Board of Education's most recent general monthly meeting.
I'd like to call this meeting to order the Newark City School District Board of Education meeting at the Roosevelt Administrative Center on Monday, December 9th, 2013 at 5 p.m. Jeff, call the roll, please.
Mr. Blind?
Here.
Mr. Bybee?
Yes.
Mr. Carr?
Yes.
Mr. Harden?
Yes.
Mrs. Nickam?
Yes.
We have a quorum of five.
Thank you. This evening, for the Pledge of Allegiance, the Air Force Junior ROTC Color Guard will present the colors, so if everyone would please rise.
Color, attack, strength, form, arms, carry, colors, forward, march. Mark time. March. Left turn. March. Color guard. Halt. Freeze that. Arms.
I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Order. Arms. Mark time. March. Right turn. March. Forward. March.
Okay, Ms. Nickam, before we get started with the presentations, I asked the color guard to come in tonight, and I'm asking a few of them to step up front and to the microphone. You know, we know them here in the city of Newark pretty well, as they're getting out to a lot of events, and that program now is completely full. A couple hundred students. I think we're about 180 some right now. 189 right now, but we know them in Newark. But what I wanted to share with the board and the community is that a lot of the people around the state are starting to get to know this group. Last year, they did a great job at the district basketball final. I just confirmed over the weekend they will be presenting the colors at the state boys basketball tournament this year at a game, which is exciting. They've been going to some competitions, so I'm going to turn it over so you can share what we've been doing.
Great. As you know, we have competition color guards.
Two of our main competition color guards are all female. Black Watch is the varsity team, and then Queens Guard is the first year team. And both of them are here with me tonight. We just started the color guard competition season for the junior ROTC, and our first competition was up in Cleveland at Midview High School. Out of 16 schools, there were schools there from Pennsylvania and Michigan, the team up north, you know. And out of those 16 teams, we actually placed, Black Watch came in first with a score of 337 out of 350. And Queens Guard, commanded by Kyra Manage, came in second place with 335, just 2 points behind. Third place was 27 points behind. So it was a great start to the season. We have three coming up in February. So what I'd like to do is let Danielle say something.
Tell us who you are.
Hi, I'm Lieutenant Colonel Danielle Davis, and my medal just fell off. We have a lot of fun on Color Guard. It means a lot to me. Kyra, can you talk?
Hi, I'm Kyra. I'm command chief in our unit, and I've been in this unit for 4 years. And I've been on color guard for 3 years. And ROTC means the world to me. It's gotten me through high school. And I probably would have dropped out if I didn't have ROTC, honestly. And my team has placed last year at every competition we went to, and the one this year, obviously. And that's
it. I'm going to add those two young ladies along with their buddies. They already take off?
No, they're back.
Okay, in the back. What a great program, great leadership we have by our instructors. But we, you know, as we always talk about, all of our students need to be leaders, and these two young ladies that stepped up are tremendous leaders in our high school, and we appreciate what you're doing. And it's kind of neat. They use the gymnasium during the day, third period, I think, most time.
Yes, sir.
Third period, the varsity competition floor for practice, and we just talked the other day, I believe you already went over right after we had done talking. And
yes, sir.
Looking at an area down by the tennis court.
Good.
Of our parking lot, and Dave's looking at me, what's this mean? Probably a little painting, Dave, but we'll do it for the kids to for practice when the weather's nice outside, so they can have their own practice pad back there. So great things coming out of that program. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. I will add that they actually presented the colors last year at the Ohio Capital Conference of Ohio School Boards Association, and as a result, I've had a couple of high school other board members ask me about our program and their interest in starting at their high schools.
Okay, we also have one other presentation. I'm going to ask our board president, Ms. Nickham, to present. Dan, if you'd stand up, please.
Thank you.
All of us know, sadly, but understandably, Mr. Bybee came on the board 4 years ago, and Dan has presented great leadership, does not have students here in the district, but had students go through, and for someone to, a lot of people are on the board when their kids are here, Dan, and so the commitment that Dan made to the district and the community and continues to make to the community is tremendous. And you know, we just wanted to share with you, Dan, how much we appreciate your work on the board, and it's just that simple. As you go around town, people, when Dan Bybee's name is brought up, everybody says he's a good man. He's a good man, and you are a good man, Dan. And we appreciate what you've done for the district, and I appreciate being around you because I think you're a tremendous leader, and I've learned a lot just hanging on your side a little bit. So thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very kindly. Appreciate it. Can I go ahead and open this,
yeah,
please? Well, we got a mirror here.
Can you look at yourself?
Yeah.
Can
you check your table? Yeah. This is inscribed, by the way. It says Dan Bybee. To honor your service, New York City Schools, December of 2013. Oh my goodness. Wow, look at this. It's a icy glass Wildcat. Oh, thank you so much. Thank you.
That Wildcat on there.
Yeah.
Got it?
There we go. Well, thank you very much, everybody, and thank you, Doug and Bev and the board members and everybody. Thank you so
Thanks,
much.
Thanks, Dan.
For the
thank you.
Since Dan has opened his gift, there's cake and punch on the side that now you can get something to eat during the, unless Dan, you want to go over and look at your cake before they cut it? Or, all right. So help yourself. Don't everybody go at once.
Yes, I do.
Well, it's a good looking cake, too.
Turn the cameras off and people will be moving.
Yeah.
Proceed.
Get a picture.
Jeff, you take a picture of the cake.
Thank you, Ben.
Thank you.
Congratulations, Dan. Move on to special reports.
Okay. Because we changed the time of the meeting, changed the kindergartner schedules at Legend. And that's our next technology group we're bringing in. We'll bring them in the next meeting that we have. Again, that's you're going to be floored by what these young kids are doing with iPads in the classroom. So we'll move on to the Newark Digital Academy. We have John Lutz, the administrator of the academy. He's going to give the board an update on achievement goals from the NDA.
Thank you for having me here tonight. To kind of ease into this presentation, I sketched down just a few quick numbers to run by you, some things that you might not realize that we were doing at the Digital Academy. So this is our 11th year in operation, so may sound new to some people, but we have been around for 11 years, and this is actually my sixth school year that I've served as a director. Currently, and that is up through last Friday, we had 290 students enrolled right now. 74% of those students are in grades 10 through 12. Okay. 66% of our student body is what we call dropout prevention students, which means that they come to us either in danger of dropping out of school or having already dropped out of school and may be in danger of dropping out of school for one of a number of reasons. Usually it's disciplinary action, attendance issues. Sometimes it's more social events like issues with juvenile court, could be due to a teen pregnancy, things like that. So 66% of our entire student body, we are K through 12, but as I said, 74% of our kids are in the upper three grades. Through last Friday, we have offered to our staff 99 and a half hours of, or to our students, 99 and a half hours of extended learning time beyond what we offer daily from 8 to 3. So that is in the form of we're open late on Tuesday nights to 7 o'clock for any students to come in and get tutoring. That's extra flex credit courses that we have. We've worked with Martha Harmon over at McGuffey to be able to offer PE twice a month to students there. So kind of a combination of all those things, but just shy of 100 hours so far this school year of extended learning opportunities for our students. And along those same lines, through last Friday, we've offered for our staff 80 hours of job-embedded professional development. So, you know, one of the things with our student body, there is always a lot to learn about working with students who are at risk. So we're trying to meet that challenge. Currently, about 17% of our student body are students with disabilities. When I was hired as a director at the beginning of the 08-09 school year, I was the only full-time employee. Now we have 32 employees, both full-time and part-time. Couple more things here. Since the beginning of this school year, we've had 146 new students enroll, and since the first day of school, we've had 75 students withdraw. So annually, we run at about 60% mobility, which means 6 out of every 10 students that we have this year won't be with us next year. So that's kind of the nature of working with at-risk kids, as you have that amount of turnover. Couple last things. Last year, 59 graduates, and the last number that I'd like to present to you is the number one, meaning that we have one mission, and that is to provide the foundation for college and career success by offering an alternative, high-quality education where any Ohio K-12 students can access tuition-free online classes and caring professional assistance. So that's a little bit of a warm-up to kind of slide into the presentation that I came here to share with you tonight. Fortunately, it's kind of small. It looks a little bit better once I put my glasses on. But this is all accessible right from the district report card. We receive a report card that is specially designed for dropout prevention credit recovery program. So it's going to look a little bit different than the report card that you see for Newark City Schools. But if you're able to locate the Newark City Schools report card on the Ohio Department of Education website, you can find this one too. It's right on the same page. So some of the things that they look at when they evaluate these dropout prevention credit recovery programs is how many of our students are passing all five sections of the Ohio graduation test. And our statistics last year was 81% of our student pool had passed all five sections. The next one down, they look at, this last year they looked at graduation rates at both four-year, five-year, and six-year rates. Our four-year rate is 29.1. Now, for most people, that sounds pretty darn low. But we don't make any excuses for that, because if you spend some time talking with my guidance counselor, what he would tell you is, very rarely do we have a week when one out of three students that come in to enroll that are grade 12 status are on track, meaning that they have 15 credits and they have a normal 12th grade year. Okay, so that's one of the reasons why they've decided that they would measure dropout prevention programs a little bit differently. If you look, if we can keep kids enrolled and keep them coming back for a fifth year, and for some even a sixth year, our graduation rate starts to approach 50%, and we feel pretty good about that, you know, with the population that we work with. You know, one of the things that we tell students when they come to enroll is, you know, we don't care if you have two, three credits and you're supposed to graduate in this upcoming May. You know, we'll welcome you with open arms, but we expect that you will stay, because we are focused on getting high school diplomas. We expect that you will stay with us for that fifth year or even that sixth year if that's what it takes. And so, you know, we try to keep our students accountable to that fact. This other number over here, this annual measurable objective, is a number that they come up with by mashing some data about math and reading rates together. And so I'm not going to get into that real deep. It's something that you could spend a lot of time discussing. I think this chart, though, speaks well of us. What they've also done for these dropout prevention credit recovery programs is compare them to other schools that serve students like the students that you're serving. And so this chart compares our school with those schools that they said were most like ours. So, you know, we feel pretty good about the work that we're doing anyway, but then when we kind of compare it to what people in other cities are doing with the same kinds of students, I think we have a lot to be proud of. And this breaks it out a little bit by reading, math, and graduation. Those are those numbers that I said they mashed together to get that overall rating of 35.1%. The baseline that they set for us, a little bit different than traditional districts. I think the reading was set at 83.4% for this year, the math at 78.5, and then this is something that we talked about when over at Columbus on October 18th, when we had a meeting about the dropout prevention credit recovery report card. They had set the graduation rate at 75.9%, which I thought was a bit ambitious, knowing, you know, the students that most of us are working for. You know, maybe when you get into the sixth and seventh year, holding people to that, you know, if you're taking public monies for that many extra years, that you should rise to that level. But out of the gate, I think that's a pretty stiff number to try to meet. But As you can see, our reading, overall reading, we were at 85.5. If we had been measured by traditional school, by a traditional school report card, we would have had groups in for 8th grade, 10th grade, and 11th grade by traditional standards. And if we were measured that way this year, we would have earned all those points. Our 8th grade reading scores were 92.9%. Our 10th grade, 76.9%, and our 11th grade, 92.3%. But a little bit about that 10th grade. We had 24 students that would have counted in that pool as being all year, full-year students. Out of those 24 students, 8 students had IEPs. So I don't know too many other people that have testing groups that over 30% of your tested population is a special needs student. So even though that number was just barely over the standard of 75% at 76.9%, again, we felt really good about the work that we were doing, you know, given the pool of students that we were working with. Math, as you can see, we have some work to do. We fell a little bit off of the standard that they had set for us. And in response to that, one of the things that we did this year, in the past, we had not had a math teacher that was available at our center every day to provide extra tutoring to students, and so that's one of the positions that we created for this school year. So hopefully we'll see those numbers start to move. Again, here's a chart that just compares us with our comparison group. So as you can see, even at 29.1, schools like ours are graduating about 10% less than that. As you take it out the fourth and fifth year, I think, you know, the positive trend that we see, and I don't quite understand how, you know, they kind of start to have an inverse trend. I think one of the things that it speaks to is if you can keep these students in school, you kind of have a critical time period where you have to make a big impact. And I'm guessing at some point in other cities, students are somewhere between that fifth and sixth year, wondering if it's still all worth the trouble. One of the things I think that we've been able to do well is keep the students engaged and keep them focused on the goal of graduating. Now, this year, this report card, they will add a year 7, okay? And then next year, they'll add year 8. And so eventually, the dropout prevention credit recovery report cards will rate schools on a 4th, 5th, 6th, 7th, and 8th year graduation rate. This year, they did not issue official rankings or ratings. This was a preliminary rating that they made available to us. So if this year they were issuing official ratings, our rating for this year, based on our results, would have met the exceed standards level. Like I said, you know, when you look at our data, you're quick to see a lot of the work that we still have ahead of us, but I think that made us feel like we're doing some of the right things now. And with that, if you have any questions, I'd be glad to do my best to answer them.
What kind of capacity do you feel like you have in the Digital Academy with regards to how many students you can take in?
Yeah, you know, that's the funny thing. With online schools, you know, statewide schools like ECOT, they have over 13,000 students. You know, our student body right now is just shy of 300, but our model is a little bit different because, you know, we want our students to be able to put a face and a name with the person that is also grading their online work. So that's why we have our staff available throughout the week at the center. If you've been down Woods or 11th Street lately and you see the addition that we're putting on the building, we're about doubling the size of the old Woodside School, what remained of it. And that is because we've grown to a point where, like I said, I think the figure was that we have 93 students a week that are coming in for some kind of tutoring, you know, staying an hour or two or maybe even half of the day. It gets real busy on Tuesdays, Wednesdays, and Thursdays, not so much on Mondays and Fridays for some reason. You know, as we push in later into the school year, especially making that final run toward graduation time, we'll probably be, you know, somewhere between 30 and 40 students coming in daily. So, you know, it's a thing. We just try to be responsive to what our students need and, you know, kind of keep pushing the boat out in the water and try to keep growing. You know, one of the things that we've been very fortunate to have the support of Mr. Ute and New York City Schools in our growth and been able to, you know, lend a hand when you know, I'd call Mr. Altepeter and say, hey, can I go over and look at that furniture before you auction it off, you know, because we could use a few new tables or something like that. So I don't know if that answers your question, but to give you an answer to that, I don't know, you know, because I don't know where it's going. I never thought when I took the job and they had averaged 72 kids a year for the first 5 years that we would been averaging over 300 kids the last 3 years. So I think part of it speaks to a coming of age of online education, but also with our contract with Newark City Schools and some of the flexibility that students that are enrolled with us have with being able to still participate in activities at Newark City Schools. I think it has been, it's given a nice option to a lot more students now than maybe it had in the past.
How many of the 300 is Newark City School students?
We average monthly but around 78 to 80% of our student body would attend a Newark City School building if they were not enrolled with us. And part of that is kind of a misnomer because one that comes to mind real quickly is a young man that is actually living in the Worthington School District, but he went to live with his father, and he had went to New York City Schools his whole life, and he wanted to keep a foot in New York City Schools. So by enrolling at the Digital Academy, when he gets ready to graduate here at the beginning, it's in June this year, isn't it? June 3rd, snow, is it?
3rd, I think.
Yeah. You know, he'll still be able to walk at White's Field with the people that he's been in school with for the previous 11 years. And so every month, you know, when we have our board meeting and I sketch all the details out for my board, we have somewhere around 15 different school districts that are represented by students that attend us. But most of it is one student here, one student there, two students here. We have the largest number of students that are not Newark students come from Heath, and the next largest would be Licking Valley, and then North Fork. But then after you get past those three, it's only one or two here or there.
Anything else for John? Thank you for presenting tonight.
Thank you.
Appreciate
it. Okay. One of the points: if a child does go, is interested, a family interested in online education, we try to steer them towards NDA because a lot of times they're back and forth a little bit. We have a great relationship. We know what John's doing, and a lot of those programs are this way. But a big key point, John mentioned the building, and when John said he was the only staff member in 07, he's built a tremendous staff, caring staff there, and a good point for our people. And I'm glad to hear that about 90 students a week are going up there. The difference between Newark Digital Academy and ECOD is they actually have a place to go physically to get help, and it's kind of in the center of our district. And so, thanks, John. Appreciate it.
Yeah, it's still on a kind of drop-in basis. You know, we don't serve lunch or anything like that. So it really works best when students are working at home, they get stuck on something, they need face-to-face time with a teacher, so they come in for an hour or two, sit down, get some one-on-one help, get the problem fixed, go home, go back to work.
Okay, we also have a strategic plan presentation by Mindy Vaughn. As Mindy steps up, I'd like to share with you, Mindy has stepped up quite a bit in this district on many things, and the strategic plan is one. A lot of districts on a strategic plan go out and hire people to do it, spend a lot of money, and a few years ago I asked Mindy to become a trainer or go to a training and then come back, and we'll do it the Newark way. We spend very little money for a great plan and a planning process, and so each year we meet to review. Mindy?
I want to thank everyone who participated in the strategic plan. We have a planning team that is very committed and puts their heart and soul into it, and we have a busy day and it's packed, but a lot of good things. Last year we reviewed the five-year review and came up with a plan. So this year there are very minimal changes, and most of the changes came down to wording to make it in compliance with the change of legislation for a new accountability standard. So I'm going to go through the plan, and the changes are highlighted so that we can look at those. The majority of the plan we didn't look at because they are the same things that every year we come back to, and they are the things that the district holds dear and that truly believes in. So as we go through it, we did not change any of the belief statements. All of those remain the same. They are the things that we believe about students and having respect for all, and that all will meet their best ability, that we're going to do all the things that we need to, and honor the fact that the family is the important piece before they ever get to school. So the belief statements didn't change. The mission statement also didn't change. The Newark Schools mission is to ensure a quality education for all students to become productive citizens in a global society. And this piece we looked at last year, and so with the reviews annually, we looked at just the pieces that really needed to be addressed. We didn't change our vision either. To accomplish the mission, our vision is that we will provide superior resources, rigorous and relevant programs, a safe and secure learning environment, and a highly skilled and caring staff in partnership with students, parents, and community members. The parameters are the things that we say what we will always do and what we will never do. So looking that students are always number one, we will look at the current research before we implement anything. We will recognize that something may not work with all students because of diversity. Involving different segments of our community in the strategic planning process, and then considering all of the components that go into the school and the interactions that happen are still the things that we engage in on a regular basis. We will never implement new programs without a positive cost-benefit analysis, and there's one piece that we are looking at in the plan before we move forward with it, which I'll point that out as we go through it. Implementing new programs without appropriate staff development and compromising our mission. The objectives are things that change. The three things that are in red aren't a lot different than what our objectives were before. However, the wording changed so that it matched the accountability system. We're still have the objective of graduating 100% of our students, having all students performing at or above grade level. The wording changed on the report card, so to achieve an overall grade of an A on the district report card by 2018, because starting next year we'll have an overall grade. This year you had subcategories. The gap closing, John talked about it a little bit, of how it applies to the Newark Digital. And the gap closing says, here's what we are setting our goal at, and here's how you performed, and you receive points towards that. It is focused on reading and math, and it replaces AYP. And we had an objective for AYP. And then also to achieve an overall grade of A on value added by 2018. And value added says, you may not be proficient, but no matter where you fall on the continuum, we expect that we're going to have positive growth with those students, that we will get a year or more worth of growth out of each student. For the strategies, there's only one strategy that changed this year, and as you can see, it really was a wording change, that we will develop and implement systems that we will ensure we will eliminate the achievement gap. All of the rest of the strategies are currently still in place, and we are still working towards those. This takes the strategies and gives you the details of what falls under each one, and I'm not going to read all of them to you because most of them did not change. The strategy for all students graduating, improving the perception, which works with what Seth Roy does on a regular basis, aligning resources and creating partnerships. This is one of the things that happens all the time whenever we're looking at doing anything in the district. Developing and implementing a program to gather student input to ensure we meet our mission. For this one, that's the student council or some forum, and again, that is an expectation that is still in place in each of the buildings. This is the one strategy that had the wording change, and it's for eliminating the achievement gap. And although the all of the subcomponents of the strategy didn't change, there was just a wording change to align that to say as well that we will have a building leadership team, we will use data to make our decisions, and everything that we do will be focused on eliminating that achievement gap. For this strategy, we will develop and implement a system to measure students' grade level achievement in all subjects. For the most part, it is wording changes. The Ohio, where it used to say that it aligned to the content standards, it's Ohio's new learning standards for academic achievement. That is what the Ohio Department of Education calls all of their reading, math, science, and social studies. All of their curriculum is the Ohio's new learning standards. So for the first one, it's K-8, a curriculum map or a pacing guide, which again was in place prior. The high school disciplines will develop a flow chart and course sequencing, which again they had prior and they've updated to go along with the new standards. And all of these are, you know, kind of fluid as ODE changes things, so we go back and revisit them. And then establishing effective and frequent communication among district teachers and parents and students regarding student achievement in all grade levels. This one changed to, it used to address progress book and the use of it across grade levels. And progress book works really nice from fourth grade on up because they have grades. K through three don't have grades, and it's a really hard thing to put into progress book and have parents really understand what that piece is. And the important part that came out of the conversation at the strategic planning team was that it's the importance of that frequent communication, whether it's through progress book, face-to-face, notes home, all of those pieces. And so that's how that one was revised. Developing and implementing an individual success plan for every student. I'm not sure why that one is in there, to be honest. The success plan, although it doesn't look like what it used to look like, we have success plans based on our RTI piece and students who are struggling, who aren't meeting, and they can be high achievers, they can be low achievers, they can hit those pieces. If they're not making progress, it doesn't look like what initially was created in at the inception of thinking about the individual success plans. And there was one that is missing. I'm not sure what happened to that. I apologize. There was one strategy that talked about doing a learning style survey with all students. And that is one that we have taken to our district leadership team to do research to say, before we spend a lot of time doing learning style surveys with kids, what does the research say? Does it say that it's a good thing? Does it say it's a bad thing? We're looking at, does it work better at one grade level versus another? How often do you do it? And so we will continue to gather that research and then report back as to where we are with that. At first glance, the research is not positive on the use of it, and there are very few that it recommends even use, and there's a cost associated with them. So we're looking very closely at that, and we will be reporting to the strategic planning team next year when we do our annual update as to where we sit with that piece. And that's it. Any questions?
Yeah, I was curious when I was looking through it. I'm sure there's a good reason that I just don't know. On the several things where we've got target dates, they're like 4 or 5 years out. What drives that they're that far out into the future?
The team had that conversation, and we spent a little bit of time on that when we set it up initially, it takes you 3 to 4 years 5 years to go through a whole plan to really get to where you want. And when it was first set up and we started with designations of effective continuous improvement, we gave ourselves that amount of time to reach those ratings. And when we looked at the fact that they're just now coming out, and each year it's the report card will look slightly different for the next 3 or 4 years, because every year they add something new to it, that we said it really will be 3 to 4 years out before the grade card is even where it's going to be and hopefully stay for a little while. So to allow time to get things in place and to look, and with the changes of assessments and standards and you know, those kinds of pieces. So there was a big conversation during that, you know, do we do a short timeline? Do we give ourselves time to really do it and do it for sustainability purposes, or do we just say, yeah, we're going to do it, and when we hit it one time, we've met it?
Mindy, my compliments on the strategic plan. I think you did an excellent job of coordinating this, and it looks like it's a great plan as we move forward. My question is this: realizing that this is a strategic plan, did you have discussions at all to address digital and electronic technologies and moving forward with that?
It did not come up in great discussion during the strategic plan. My thought on that is that it plays into multiple strategies that are currently in place. It's just an avenue of which to reach some of the goals and pieces of the plan, and how you reach those. You know, if we want to get more specific with those, then you know, with starting the bring your own device and having the school within a school and those pieces, we would be at a better place to say, here's the effect we've had, here's what we've learned from it, here's what we've, you know, want to change. So, but right now it just allows them to be a tool to use to meet any of the strategies that we currently have.
Okay, thank you.
But some of the technology is implied, right? Because like the testing will be required to be taken online.
Correct. Correct.
In the near future, right?
Correct. Next year, to be exact.
Any other questions for Mindy? Strategic plan? Thank you, Mindy. Mm-hmm. Okay, and now, is it the last?
Yep.
Now we'll move on to communications from the floor. Anyone wishing to address the board can come to the podium. Please give your name and address, and you may address the board for up to 5 minutes. Does anyone wish to address the board at this time? If not, we'll move on to treasurer's recommendations.
Item 2A, approval of minutes, Board of Education meetings for October 25th, 2013 special meeting, and November 5th, 2013 regular meeting. Item 2B, approval of November 2013 financial statements and payment to vendors, including interest earned in the amount of $3,081.47. Our fund breakdown, which I've presented to the board, is general fund has $18,890,000, bond retirement has $440,000, permanent improvement has $1,310,000, building fund has $290,000, food service has $1,004,000. OSSC Project Local has $120,000. OSSC Project State Share is $2,004,000. Classroom facilities is $2,410,000. Other miscellaneous grants and funds is $920,000. Total is $27,460,000, which reconciles to the bank actual balance of $27,459,845.14. Item 2C is approval of the supplemental permanent appropriations. 018 increases $4,000 for a heritage fundraiser that was completed. 019 increases $499 for an iPad grant from Jody Gwynn and for John Klein. And item 300, Liberty Athletic Fund, is the correction of $1,350 that was discussed at the last board meeting. Item 2D is approval to pay invoice. It is recommended the Board of Education approve payment of invoices for the school resource officer as shown in the appendix. Reason this is on the board agenda is the March invoice got temporarily lost between us and the city some way somehow. So we got to pay up for the March one, and then we also have the one on there for this fall also. So the reason it's on there is because of being a past due invoice, if you will, so to speak. I'm required to inform all of you of that.
And I'm not pointing the finger at the city, as long as they don't point the finger at me that somehow we got it lost between the two of us. Okay? And then the item 2E is approval to participate in OSBA Legal Assistance Fund. It is recommended the Board of Education approve participating in the OSBA Legal Assistance Fund and authorizes the treasurer to pay the invoice in the amount of $250 as shown in the appendix. And at this time, I would hope the board would consider item 2A through 2E. F and G will be considered separately.
Do I have a motion to approve treasurer's recommendations 2A through E?
So moved.
Second.
Purdue's moved. Thomas second. Any questions or discussion? Not call the roll, please. Jeff?
Mr. Harden?
Yes.
Mr. Blind?
Yes.
Mr. Bybee?
Yes.
Mr. Carr?
Yes.
Mrs. Nickum?
Yes. Motion carries.
Item F is a date, time, and place for organizational meeting. The board is asked to set a date, time, and place for the organizational meeting in January 2014. Legally, we are required to have that before January 15th so that I can submit some reports and stuff that the state requires by the 15th of January.
Okay, recommendations for dates of this meeting are the Friday the 3rd, Saturday the 4th, and Saturday the 11th.
Somebody want to make a motion for a date?
Friday's fine.
Fridays are tough for me.
Saturday's fine.
Saturday the
4th. Saturday the 4th. That means we have the meeting Saturday, January 4th.
And then we'll do the.
We better vote on this first. Go ahead and vote on this. Set this, and then do the second one. Yeah,
we'll have regular meeting.
Yeah, have this set. That way, if they nominate somebody for President Pro Tem and they can't make it,
I mean for the regular meeting to follow the organizational
meeting. Okay. All right. Go ahead. Discuss that.
And then what we've typically done is just the regular meeting follows, the regular meeting for the month of January follows the organizational meeting.
That's fine.
Is that an issue with the financial statements?
God willing, it won't be. All right. If it is, we'll give you the best report we can at that time and follow up with emails to correct anything that I didn't have.
Okay. Tim has made a motion that we have the organizational meeting on the 3rd. On the 4th.
Second.
Saturday the 4th. Kurt is second. Any discussion, comments? Call the roll, please, Jeff.
Mr. Carr?
Yes.
Mr. Harden?
Yes.
Mr. Blind?
Yes.
Mr. Bybee?
Yes.
Mrs. Nickum. Really don't matter, does it?
6 a.m., right, Dan?
Dan's perfectly fine.
8 a.m. on that.
8 a.m.
And that's including the regular meeting, too.
Here at the Roosevelt building.
Here at Roosevelt, starting at 8 a.m.
8 a.m. in the morning? Wait a minute.
Got it.
Don't worry, send my vote now.
Item 2G is appoint a president pro tem for the meeting that you just set.
I'll move Bev Nickum.
Second.
Tom is moving. Kurt is second. Bev Nickum serves as president pro tem for the organizational meeting. Any further nominations or discussion? Call the roll, please, Jeff.
Mr. Blind?
Yes.
Mr. Harden?
Yes.
Mr. Bybee?
Yes.
Mr. Carr?
Yes.
Mrs. Nickum?
Yes.
Thank you.
Motion carries. Superintendent's recommendations.
Okay, under personnel, we have one retirement, and that is Tracy Kerr-Mount, who is a language arts teacher at Liberty. We wish her well and thank her for her time. Her husband, Rod, retired last year, so good for them. And Tracy's a good lady. She's done a wonderful job for us. But something a little bit different. She will be retiring on March 1st instead of at the end of the school year. So she'll be out March 1st, and to which we will bring a qualified person in to replace her. So we appreciate her time. Supplemental contracts, Carl McLean, wrestling coach. He's going to work with the elementary kids a little bit. Greg Forsythe, head varsity football coach. I want to point out with Greg that we really appreciate
his time and efforts, not only in the classroom, but on the football field. And I can tell you the last 4 years, our kids have always worked hard, played hard, and been good citizens on the football field. And so I'm proud of our kids for that under Greg's leadership. We have one leave of absence, appointments and assignments. We have one. Item 5, salary adjustments. I would just point out Jody King is not a first grade teacher. She's a fourth grade teacher, the fourth one down, still at Hillview. We have a list of tutors to be approved. Also, substitutes are on there. And then item 8, under other, termination of an employee, Stacy Colnott, bus driver, 90-day probationary period. So I recommend the board approve items 1 through 8.
Okay, do I have a motion to approve superintendent's recommendations A, personnel 1 through 8?
So moved.
Second.
Dan is moved, Tim is second. Any discussion or questions? Not call the roll, please, Jeff.
Mr. Bybee?
Yes.
Mr. Carr?
Yes.
Mr. Blind?
Yes.
Mr. Harden?
Yes.
Mrs. Nickum?
Yes. Motion carries.
Okay, students in curriculum, under item 2, you'll see the normal special education contracts. And again, I'll point out, some people always ask, why are they so far around other districts? A lot of those are foster place kids that we are responsible to educate. Item 6, approval of out-of-state field trips. The band to Chicago on March 22nd through 24th, which is very exciting for the band kids. I'm glad they get an opportunity to go out of state, and they've worked hard, and it's been a good trip for them this spring.
Okay, do I have a motion to approve superintendent's recommendations B, students in curriculum, 1 through 6?
So moved.
Tom is moved. I have a second.
Second.
Kurt is second. Any questions or discussion? That band trip is over spring break.
Yeah.
And my son asked me to not go on the trip. As a matter of fact, looking for parents, and he specifically asked me not to go.
Yeah, that happens to all of us.
Welcome to the teenage years.
Obviously, you can't take a hint, so you have to tell you.
They'll come back around.
Call the roll.
For money, usually.
I'm sure there's a lot of time.
Mr. Blind?
Yes.
Mr. Harden?
Yes.
Mr. Bybee?
Yes.
Mr. Carr?
Yes.
Mrs. Nickum?
Yes.
Okay, item C, gifts. Thank you, Mr. and Lucky Jeff Anderson over here. Monetary from Belfour USA Group, $100. Jeff's name was drawn at the Capitol Conference in November, and he was awarded $100. So Mr. Anderson's donating $100 to the Newark City Schools General Fund. Duly noted from the Ethics Commission there, right, Jeff?
Absolutely. And, say it loud for the Ethics Commission, yeah.
Yes, but that's great. So thank you, Jeff, for that. And a monetary from State Farm Insurance, $1,500 to Carson Elementary. And I believe, did Mindy step out? No, no, she's over there. Mindy, what are they using this for?
To be honest, I'm not sure.
Okay. I thought we talked about it earlier today. I thought it was a student wellness initiative. But in any event, Carson will put this to good use. And again, thanks State Farm for not only being such a good neighbor, their support of our students is unbelievable. So thank you.
Do I have a motion to approve superintendent's recommendation C, gifts?
So moved.
Second.
Kurt is moved. Tim is second. Any discussion or questions? Thank you, Jeff and State Farm. Call the roll, please.
Mr. Harden?
Yes.
Mr. Carr?
Yes.
Mr. Blind?
Yes.
Mr. Bybee?
Yes.
Mrs. Nickum?
Yes. Motion carries.
And item D, we have a lot of business going on in the Newark City Schools, but none this month for the board to approve.
Very good. Thank you. Doug, and now do I have a motion to approve the strategic plan as presented this evening?
So moved.
Second.
Kurt is moved. Tom is second. Any questions or discussion on the strategic plan? Call the roll, please, Jeff.
Mr. Harden?
Yes.
Mr. Blind?
Yes.
Mr. Bybee?
Yes.
Mr. Carr?
Yes.
Mrs. Nickum?
Yes.
Motion carries. Now we'll go
to board discussion. Start with Tim.
Well, thanks to John Luce for coming and sharing with us about the Digital Academy. Certainly, that's a lot of students. You're doing a great job there, it looks like. So, Dan, thank you.
You're welcome.
Learned a lot from you.
Thank you.
And watching you and your wisdom. Appreciate your time for New York City Schools. And just want to wish everybody a Merry Christmas.
We don't need a vote on it.
Thank you. I'd like to thank and congratulate our junior ROTC students. And I think to hear the one young lady stand there and say that if not for junior ROTC, she probably would not still be in school sort of explains why the board thought it was so important a few years ago to start this program. We're lucky to have the opportunity to do it, and it's just great the way it's working out. 189 students is amazing. Dan.
You're leaving.
Well, I'll still be here.
I think by nature of this job, we tend to focus on the things that need improved, the things that need fixed. And it's always good to step back and take a look at just how much is good. And I want to thank you for always being there, telling us that, helping us remember how much is going on good in this system, as well as our millions of viewers and the other people out there. I think that is a very important service that you've served along with everything else, and I thank you.
Well, I just want to take a minute to thank and to let everyone know how grateful I am for the opportunity to serve on the school board this last 4 years. I can remember very clearly, very vividly, about 4.5 years ago, Bev and I were downtown, and we were having one of the community meetings and gave an opportunity for folks in the community to ask us questions because we were just running for school board. And I can remember one of the questions that a gentleman asked me is, do you think that there is a problem with the perception of New York City schools? And I took a while to reflect on an answer for that because my perspective was probably a little bit different than most. My perspective was from my daughter that had just come through the entire New York City school system. She came through the grade school, the middle school, and the high school, and her perspective was pretty good. She did very well, and she had a lot of support of teachers. She had a lot of support of people in the community, and also our neighbors. So again, my perspective was the perception was pretty good, but I also realized that there were areas within our school district that did need some improvement, and at that time the graduation rate was not very good, and there were some other issues that needed some attention too. And so with that knowledge of moving forward, we started to gather some momentum to put us in a better place. And you know, my thing about being on the school board, and you've heard me talk about this time and time again, is maintaining that positive momentum, move forward. And my gosh, if you look at how far we've come in the last 4 years with the facilities that we have, with the school buildings, and with the dress policy that we have, and the graduation rate improvement, and you know, Doug, you've done a great job this just going down the line about how much better we've gotten over the years, and we have to continue that momentum. Yeah, I'm moving on. It's time for me to move on, and it's time to let somebody else step in to take my place. But I just hope that the board, and I know that you do, realize how important it is to maintain that positive momentum as we move forward. I've had a great pleasure to work with everybody here on the board, and I want to thank you all. Tim, I want to thank you, and Tom, with your friendship, and I've learned a great deal with you. My friend Bev, my gosh, we've talked from time to time, and her leadership as president. It's been a great comfort to me to know that we move forward with your leadership as president. And Doug, your tireless effort in the community here to take this school district to a better place, and you need a great leader to be able to do that. not just anybody, but a great leader. And Doug, I think that you continue to provide us with the leadership that we need to move us forward. So I want to thank you for that.
Thank you.
And Kurt, you know, we've been friends for a long time, and I was just so pleased when you heard that you had an interest in coming on the school board, because your reputation speaks for itself in the community about the leadership that you've provided. And I just want you to let you know how much I appreciate getting to know you better and working with you. And Jeff, probably not many people I know that has more of a passion for this school district and what we do. It certainly has compelled me to a new level to think about what we do in the community. So thank you for your leadership as treasurer. But you know, we have a lot of people in the audience here to thank, and I do. And Seth and Gemma, the job that you guys have done since you stepped into your positions, it's certainly appreciated. And I've enjoyed getting to know you better too over the years. Our administrators, Barb and Mindy and Mara, my gosh, you know, you guys are the ones that do the heavy lifting, in my opinion. We provide leadership, and strategically, yeah, that's our job, is to provide you leadership, but you're the ones that then take this leadership and tactically put it in place. And again, the results speak for itself about how much we're able to maintain that momentum. And you're to be complimented on your abilities to move forward and put us in a better place. And I don't want to forget about Dave. Dave, I can't see you back there, but there you are. Yeah. My gosh, you know, if you look at our facilities and everything that this man is involved with, you can see it's self-evident the improvements that we've seen in our district as we move forward. So you can see that we've done a good job of maintaining momentum. And as I leave, I just challenge the board and those in your various positions to take that challenge and keep that momentum moving forward, because we are in a better place now. And I just want to thank you for letting me be part of the school board moving us forward. So thank you all very much.
Jeff. I just wanted to say thank you, Mr. Bybee, for serving the students of Newark City Schools, because ultimately that's who you're really serving. You served with us on the board. You've helped advise and counsel in financial situations that I've greatly appreciated, because you were a very calming effect on a treasurer that can get pretty intense at times. So I want to thank you for those times that you have brought me back down to earth and kept me a little bit level. So I appreciate your service on the board. Mr. Blowers has big shoes to fill. I don't know what size shoe you wear, but it's a big shoe for him to fill. And we're looking forward to him coming on board the board. It's the first time that I've had a chance, I think, to officially thank the voters for renewing our levy. And a promise that I'll make to you is we'll continue to be fiscally sound and do the best job we can for the voters that pay the taxes, and for the students of this school district, that we get the most bang for our buck. And I want to welcome Mr. Blowers on the board, starting apparently with January 4th, right, in our business meeting. So thank you. It's a great time to be a CAT.
I also want to thank Dan. Thank you, Dan, for your service. You get the theme from hearing everyone's comments here, but the thing that I noticed the most about Dan, and it pulls from some of the themes, is that I can think of numerous times where we've been discussing an issue, we've been deep into that discussion, and it's Dan who seems to have this perspective that he'll sort of drop on us, like, I don't see why you see that as an issue or that. And generally, that's what pulls you back out of the mire. And it's been that perspective and that guidance that Dan has given us so many times on so many subjects that has really helped me, Dan. And I've very much appreciated that. It's that, as Jeff said, it's that calming effect. And as Tom said, it's that that ability to appreciate what's right about this place before you go about the always necessary task of improving. And I've always admired that in you, Dan, and I really do appreciate your leadership. So thank you.
I'd like to welcome Hannah Sparling. Hannah, raise your hand out there, please. Our new reporter at The Advocate. Hannah's not leaving us. She's still going to be at The Advocate, but I saw that email come about, and I saw the name Hannah Sparling, and I was like, man, that sounds familiar. Hannah's father is the principal at Marion Pleasant High School. He was the principal there for a long time because I was the principal at Marion Elgin when her father Brian came there, and I know it's a good family, and so welcome. And I already shared with her, I checked with some of the staff members at Pleasant, said she's supposed to take care of us, so we're going to let them know. And so, anyhow, welcome, Hannah. I can't believe a half year is just about to be completed in the district, and it's been a pretty quick start to the year, and I'd like to thank about 800 staff members and about 6,400 students in our community for getting off to such a good start, and our buildings are so they're wonderful. I'm all about attitude, environment in our buildings, and are just spectacular, and I appreciate all the leadership that we get. ROTC program, again, not only are they getting recognized in Newark, it's starting to go statewide, and I'm really excited that they'll get a chance to present the flag in front of about possibly 15,000 to 18,000 people at the Schottenstein Center in March, which is going to be great for Newark. The only thing that would even make that better is if it's prior to the Newark Wildcat game at the Schott. We'll pick that game if that happens. No pressure, Jeff Quackenbush. A lot of holiday programs. I know Dan and I are both on the Mental Health of America board, and so I guess still hang out with Dan at board meetings from that standpoint, but I'll be running the two programs. Dan's the president there, so I'm going to tell you now, I've got to leave a little bit early on Thursday, I think it is.
Thursday.
I get to a few programs. We've got a lot of programs going on in the district, so if you get a chance, get out and check that out. We have one tonight at 7 o'clock, and Mr. Carr will be heading over there, and might head there into the basketball game tonight. We'll see. But a lot of work goes into those, so we appreciate everybody that helps us with those programs. And then a final word for Dan tonight, that Dan, I know you love your family, and you got a great family, and they're spread out three or four states, grandkids, and I know that you're traveling around, you and Mrs. Bybee are, and Mrs. Bybee just walked in. I want to thank you for supporting Dan and allowing him to do this the past 4 years, because I know how busy you guys are, and it takes a lot from family life to do that. So good people surround himself with really good people. And if you see there, some of them just came in. Dan lives in a great neighborhood with a lot of good friends, and I know they support you too. So thank you guys for supporting Dan a lot of times. So.
Well, Dan, I've known this moment would come since August, and I've dreaded it. We've campaigned together. We've done strategic planning together. We've done finance together. We've done executive committee together. And I look back on all that fondly. I respect you greatly. You know that. I appreciate everything you've done for the district and for me personally. Like Chris says, you ground us. You bring us back. Many of the comments that you made in our discussions have caused me to pause and reevaluate the way I was looking at things, and you've even changed my mind a couple of times, not every time. We've had to agree to disagree on some of the things, but it's been a great pleasure and an honor to serve with you the last 4 years, and you will be great with us. I will miss you, but I'm proud of you, and I'm glad that you're moving on and will be able to travel more get to do more things with your family. And who knew that you saying the one word momentum 4 years ago were to create a firestorm where not a day goes by that the word momentum is not mentioned in our district. Great. And we ran a whole, you know, levy campaign on that word. And so thank you so much for everything you've done for the district and the students and for serving with me.
I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Now entertain a motion for adjournment.
So moved.
So.
Bruce moved. Tom is second.
Tom is ten.
Those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed, nays.
616.
Meeting adjourned.
Can we cut the cake now?